But Metro, under Christoph Spieler's leadership, he is a board member there, has been working for a year at least on completely reimagining the bus system, starting with a blank slate and saying, what would we do if we were trying to be rational? And so that's what we're coming up with. Now we have this plan, and it's out for public comment right now. And I think it's very exciting, and it's one of the most interesting plans, I think, going on in the country, because it sort of creates a whole new, very, very functional bus system without spending any new money to speak of. So Christoph, I'll just let you go for it. Thank you. And you're all welcome to sit here.
Okay, I'm
going to
see if I can see how far my remote stretches, because it's odd to stand in the middle of the room. So let's see if this works. As David said, I am a Metro board member appointed by Amy Parker, City of Houston representative. The warning I give at the beginning of this talk is the great benefit I have for a board member is I get to speak for myself. I am one vote out of nine. So you will hear some opinions here that may be my opinion rather than official Metro policy. Okay. When we talk about transit, we tend to talk about light rail, and commuter rail, and BRT, and ferry boats, and we talk about almost everything except this, which is the local bus system, which is the backbone of what we do. It is the largest ridership at Metro. It is the largest expense year in, year out. Wherever you go in the country, local buses like this are doing amazing work getting people about their day. But I would also argue that wherever you go in the country, you will see that nobody, from a planning standpoint, from a transit standpoint, is paying that much attention to these. Before we start, I'd actually love to do the quiz. See how well you know the system. Which transit center is this? Can anybody identify it? What? No. That's Magnolia Transit Center, end of the light rail line on the East End. So, as David talked about, what Metro is doing is really rethinking our entire local bus system. So I want to talk about that today. I want to talk about what we're trying to fix. I want to talk about what we're doing to fix it. And I want to talk about how you can help make all of this happen. So what is reimagining? The first really important thing to note here, especially in this room, I mean, this is a room where 2030 seems like tomorrow, where we are always talking about big projects on very long timelines. This is a short-term plan. The goal is to have these routes running down the street, a totally new network in place by next June. Secondly, this is not about spending more money. All of the maps I will show you are for a system that costs the same amount of money to operate as the local bus system we operate today more effectively. And finally, what I'm showing you today is a draft. And we know that by the time this plan is adopted by the Metro Board this fall, it will have changed. And the reason it will have changed is people who live in a neighborhood, people who work in that neighborhood, people who do business in that neighborhood know a lot more than a planner sitting at 1900 Main about that neighborhood. We are going to get some very good ideas in this process, and we want to incorporate those ideas in this plan. Timeline-wise, we selected our consultant, who is actually sitting in the audience, Jeff Carlton, who I may pull up when it comes to Q&A. Who has been leading that plan. We selected our consultants back in 2012. Jared Walker, who writes the blog Human Transit and probably the best book I've ever read on transit, also titled Human Transit, is on the consultant team as well. Started this in 2012. We started by really pulling together existing conditions information. If you're a real wonk, go on the Transit Reimagining website and you will find a document which includes a page of analysis of every Metro local bus route, including comments as to what works and doesn't work and a full set of every boarding. We know where everybody gets on this system, and this is really the first time Metro has used that data to really rethink the entire system. This is a very data-driven process. And then we moved into defining goals, which is a very important step, actually saying what is the purpose of our system and what are we trying to do. Moved into the draft plan. We are now in about 3 months of public outreach, really running through July. We have public meetings all over the region going on right now. Then we'll revise and finalize the plan, and then the planners at Metro will have a lot of work to do to actually figure out exactly when every bus is where every bus driver has to show up, and then implement it next June. Stakeholders have been a huge part of this, and I see multiple of you in the audience here who are in the room here. We've been having stakeholder meetings since the beginning, really bringing together people who represent the communities we serve and all the different kinds of destinations we serve: hospitals, educational institutions, social service, our member jurisdictions, to really make this a collaborative plan. Why are we doing this? The first most fundamental reason is we have heard from our riders that we could do a lot better here. The community has told us we want a better local bus system. So what does that mean? I would argue, and this is from personal experience, because I'm a frequent local bus rider, just got on 53 to get here today, that our system is difficult to learn, it is difficult to understand, and it is difficult to make connections. Let me show you some examples of what we're talking about. This is the Route 40. On this end, it has two branches. Through here, it has an Ignosa. The two branches actually cross each other. Here, it has an express segment. So if you think you're getting on a Route 40 to go right here, if you accidentally get on the express segment, it'll just speed right by where you're trying to go. And then at the south end, it has three different loops which actually utilize the same set of streets. I have not yet found anybody who can explain to me how this functions. I can guarantee you cannot figure it out from the Metro schedule, how that actually operates. The bus drivers know where they're going. But other than that, I have no idea how that actually functions. This is one route. This is described by one number, but this is an absolute mess. And you might look at this and think that this was designed by my rabbit with a really short attention span. And if he were designing a route, it would look like this. But that's not how routes like this happen. These happen through a slow process of historical accretion. You start with a route, and then there's a request for service here, a request here, a request here. And if you have a transit board and an agency leadership who basically says to a transit planner, we want you to serve that need, that new shopping center, that hospital, whatever, we want you to serve that need, but we want you to change as little as possible, these are the kind of routes you come up with. You do a series of changes. Individually, every one of those changes looks like it makes sense. They add up to something that definitely doesn't make sense. This is Shepherd in today's system, and I'm showing you every bus route that combines to serve Shepherd. So we've got one set of routes here. Notice that these are loop routes, so the even-numbered route, the odd-numbered route are the clockwise and the counterclockwise versions of this. And then here, a different bus takes over, and it takes you to here, and then here, a different bus takes over, but then leaves the street, and there's no service at all here, and there's another bus route here. Just making a trip from one part of Shepherd to another, and we'll hold questions till the end, just making a trip from another part of Shepherd to another is a real undertaking.
Could you just make your pointer more pointer?
What?
We can't see the pointer.
Oh, okay. I'll try pointing on the screen. Here's another fun one. This is the Route 60 at its southern end. And once again, the result of a series of extensions leading to a really fun fact. You are waiting for the bus right here. That's an 8-minute walk and a 20-minute bus ride. Wow. So at the exact moment that the bus shows up at the stop, you would actually be faster to just start walking than to get on that bus at that stop. Once again, a series of extensions, this one service, and at the end you end up with a system that really doesn't make much sense, and that's also very difficult to understand. You're seeing some more one-way loops over here. Another favorite example, this is the 11 Nance, my favorite bus name in Houston. This is, in the 1920s, the Nance streetcar route. I have highlighted in yellow the extent of the street we know as Nance. And if you look at this route, this is a streetcar line that should be called the Nance streetcar. It serves the entire length of the street and it connects it into downtown. It's incredibly logical. Over time, stuff happens. First of all, the city starts growing outwards, so this gets extended. Then new community centers are built, new high schools, and all of those are reasons to sort of add to the route, add little deviations to serve things. And then at some point in the 50s, 60s, TxDOT comes in and builds I-10. And when they build I-10, they actually chop Nance into two pieces. The section of Nance that you might know, Last Concert Cafe, et cetera, and a very brief section here. So what does this route look like today? Here is today's Nance bus.
Oh, wow.
It is on Nance for three blocks. And on that section of Nance, no one has ever heard of. But it is still called the Nance, since this is a direct descendant of that streetcar route. That name is not helping anyone navigate the system. We also have very few frequent routes. If you think of a bus system like this, you're actually thinking of it wrong. All routes are not the same thing. How often a bus comes is incredibly important. Frequency is the key to transit. Jarrett Walker, my favorite way he has of illustrating this is, imagine you have a driveway with a gate at the end that opens every 30 minutes. Say you want to get somewhere faster. What do? Do you buy a sports car, or do you get that gate to open more often? It's all about frequency. And if you look at the system in terms of frequency, you will see our routes are all over the place. This is number 85 and number 36 on Washington Avenue. Notice morning peak, very frequent service, very quickly drops off by midday. We're getting service every hour or so. Picks up again in the evening, but notice even this isn't entirely regular. There's a big gap and then two buses right after each other. And then in the evening, another bus number takes over the route. So this is not the kind of thing where you can just show up and know a bus is going to be there. This is something where you have to plan your life around the transit and not vice versa. This is what our current system looks like. So roughly 15 minutes means that a bus, you don't have to think about a schedule to ride that bus. So if we've got a frequency of 15 minutes or better, that's frequent service, that means you can just show up and you know a bus will be coming along. This is our current system, and the red is what we have in terms of frequent service. Notice how many blues we have out there. Notice how many greens we have out there. Most of our routes are infrequent, and that is a really big inconvenience to our passengers. You look at the weekend, it gets a lot worse. So here's weekday. Here's Saturday. Notice how many of those frequent routes dropped away. And watch places like this. We are seeing entire neighborhoods drop off the map. And now I'm going to go to Sunday, and this is pretty depressing. Why does this matter? Well, first of all, if I'm going to depend on transit for my life, that isn't just about getting to work. I also have to get to the grocery store. I have to get to school. I have to do all the other things I need to do in my day. And if I need to get to the grocery store on a Sunday morning and my bus route isn't there, or if it's infrequent, that's a very big deal as a transit rider. But secondly, if I'm shopping at the grocery store, that means somebody has a job at the grocery store on Sunday morning. There's an awful lot of jobs that aren't 9-to-5, and our system is based around 9-to-5 jobs. Weekend service is about serving all of those other jobs and all of those other trips. And we're not doing it very well at all. I've heard the word transit desert. That to me is the definition of a transit desert. When we have entire neighborhoods where we lose service or where there's only a bus an hour snaking through the neighborhood. And the frequent service is very much radial. Our entire system is radial. It's based on getting people to downtown. And the reality is most of our riders aren't going downtown. So downtown has turned into a gigantic, inconvenient transit center. What all of this has meant is that we have seen a significant ridership decline. There's our local bus ridership. And now you may look at that and say, that's because Metro cut service. But look at that line. That's how much service we've provided. We are providing more service and carrying fewer people, which is just about the definition of doing something wrong. And we can find that same statistics in other things. This is the Downtown Houston Commute Survey. Downtown workers and how many of them use transit. For the people who live outside Beltway 8, in the range of the park and rides, we have 50% of downtown workers choosing to use transit. For the people inside 610, it's somewhere around 20%. What this is saying is when we provide good transit service, Houstonians will ride it, but obviously we're doing something wrong in here. Also, this region is growing. This region is changing. We're in an employment center right now that didn't exist in the 1920s. There are jobs all over the region, there are people all over the region, and we don't serve it very well. Here is population density. And what's notable about Houston is our densest populated areas are outside the 610 loop on the west side. And look at the footprint of our frequent system and how badly it's serving those areas. The southwest and the west side has a huge amount of demand, and we're not serving. And you would say very similar thing for jobs. Here's our major employment centers, and look at the transit use. Downtown TMC are well connected to the transit system, get over 30% of those employees using transit. Look at those others, 5%, 7%, 2%. Greenway Plaza ought to have a much higher share than that. And this is a sign that we're not providing good service connecting to here. We also have a huge opportunity here. New rail lines means we can make the bus system better. We can use rail as that higher speed, higher capacity, higher frequency, highly reliable service into downtown. If you look at our map, every bus route that's shaded on this map is a bus route that connects to one of the rail lines outside of downtown in the TMC. So notice how much of an opportunity there is to rethink that system. We don't have to run a bunch of buses parallel to a rail line. It gives us the opportunity to really set up crosstown service that connects to that rail line, but connects to a lot of other places besides. And so it's all about how can we really leverage bus and rail together as a system. And then finally, we're going to keep growing. So what we want is a plan that actually sets up a system that we can build on for decades to come. So we did all of this, as David said, by literally taking a blank sheet look at the bus system. We said to the consultants, don't just tweak our routes, just start over. Tell us with what we know about where people live and where they work and where they're trying to get on transit, what the best system would be to serve them. We think that system meets all of these goals. Much simpler, more frequent service, 7 days a week. Ridership increase of 20% in the near term, 2 years. A much better match with where people live and work. Much better connections between bus and rail. And a very clear foundation to move forward. So let's talk about that. First of all, as I said before, we tend to sort of classify things like this. We tend to think there's park and ride, there's local, and there's rail. Part of this thinking is that local bus actually consists of a couple of different kinds of service. There is frequent local service, which, like I said, is that show up and go. It's there all the time whenever you need it service. Then there are sort of the supporting routes, which are the 30-minute frequency kind of stuff, maybe hour frequency, which are really feeders into that system and support to that system. And then finally, where we need it in low-density neighborhoods with really spread out destinations, there's alternate kinds of service, and we're suggesting flex routes. I won't go into detail on that today. There's a whole other presentation on flex routes here. But really, tailoring service to different transit needs in different corridors. So here is the existing network. Red routes are frequent, every 15 minutes or better. The blue routes are 16 to 30. And the green routes are more than 30. Here is today's system. Here is what we are proposing. Look at that improvement in terms of the number of frequent routes. Look at how much better that serves all of the growth we have seen on the west side. Think about all of that density down here. Think about all of these jobs up here and how much better it's serving those places. But at the same time, look at the east side of town. Look at the Third Ward in U of H. And notice how much better service is getting there. Across the board, you are seeing improvements. And the other thing, and it's harder to see, but if you start to look at it, you can notice a distinct simplification in this network. Look at this part of town, for example, and notice how much simpler that network looks. I'll talk about the grid and how important that is as a part of this. This is midday frequency. If you look at the peak, this is peak frequency. So you can see at the peak, we can ramp that even more, and look at these West Side job centers and how much benefit you see there from that peak service. So what does this do? I'll go through each of these. Like I said, we're looking at a conservative 20% increase in ridership as a result. So first of all, more frequent routes to more places. Those frequent routes are truly a different kind of service than the less frequent. It's that zone within which you can travel when you want to and get where you want to. So what does that look like today? On our system today, these are the frequent routes. And so what I'm showing here is what's within walking distance of those routes. This is our frequent service zone. If you live within this zone, you can access all of the destinations in this zone without having to look at a bus schedule. That's not a bad zone. There's, you know, downtown TMC. We've got sort of uptown hanging out here. There's definitely a lot of places within that. So that's today's network. What we are proposing is a dramatic increase in that frequent network. Adding a lot more neighborhoods, adding a lot more centers to that. And it's all about a grid. The great advantage of a grid is it does not privilege one place over another. When you are on a grid, any two points on that grid, you can find a direct route that connects them. So the nice thing about a grid is we're not saying downtown is more important than any other place, but we're also not saying that Greenway is more important than any other place. We're putting them all on a grid, so regardless where you want to go within that zone, it connects. So here's our local example. We are sitting here right now, and under this plan, there will be a frequent bus down Richmond Avenue. That bus hits Greenway Plaza, it hits Uptown, it hits West Chase, if you go the other direction, it hits Neartown, it hits Midtown, it hits the Third Ward, TSU and U of A, and it ends up at the East End. So just that one frequent bus is already connecting you to a lot of places. But a network is about the power of connection. So now let me show you every route on the frequent network that connects to that bus route, every place you can go with one connection. And notice now we have added essentially all of the major job centers within the urban core, as well as all the way out to Greens Point, West Chase, Memorial City, to that network. That's a lot of places you can get to very easily. That's what the grid is about. And as you trace out those trips, you'll notice, if I'm here, I want to get to Memorial City. It's a nice, simple L-shaped trip. Wherever I'm going, you'll see that the route does not take me out of the way to get there. So there's that zone today. There's what that zone looks like on a Sunday. Here's what that zone looks like under reimagined. Because what we are saying here is those frequent routes aren't just frequent on a weekday, they're frequent all day, 7 days a week. So if you need to get to the grocery store on Sunday, that service is there for you. Jay Crossley and I, a long time ago, were talking about how do we define Houston, and the inside the loop and outside the loop designation is wrong, because it doesn't actually reflect what the density is. And we drew something we call the blob, which basically extended from downtown westwards all the way out pretty much to State Highway 6 in some areas. And that's really what this is. What's within this zone is a million people and a million jobs within that area. So let's compare to other cities. Let's look at some of our peers here. Here is Dallas. On a weekday at midday, their entire light rail system is not part of frequent service. If you want to get out to Plano, there's only a train every 20 minutes. And Sunday is pathetic. Here's Atlanta. You'll see something very similar. This is their, notice it's rail lines and a couple of bus routes, all radial, all centered on downtown, and how much that drops off on a Sunday. Here's Minneapolis. Their network is much stronger, but once again, you go to a Sunday, that really falls off. Salt Lake City, apparently people don't want to get anywhere in Salt Lake City on a Sunday. The light rail line isn't even running at 9 a.m. on a Sunday. Denver, all of those bus routes, look at that on Sunday. Portland, we all think Portland is this great transit city, but that's pathetic. Notice how this is only rail, and it's only 10% of the rail system that makes that frequent service on a Sunday morning. This is us. Now, compare the size of that to everything else you've seen, and you're seeing that this will be one of the biggest frequent transit networks in the country. That's really cool. It's really cool to be up here and talking about our transit being better than Portland's. I mean, we know we're better than Dallas, that's obvious. Another big part of this is making everything simpler and easier to understand. Simple, straight routes, better maps, tools, route numbering, route names. I mean, the idea that there's a route called the Shepherd that runs the entire length of Shepherd. You know, going from that to that. I mean, how much easier is it to navigate a system that has that kind of logic? And that includes making a lot of connections a lot directer. We are on Richmond right now, or out here, and there is a Richmond bus. That Richmond bus runs to Main Street, pulls into Wheeler Station, and stops. So say I want to get from over here, say to Houston Tomorrow offices, and say I want to get across town to TSU. I will note that Richmond and Wheeler are the same street. Here's what that route looks like. This is our current system. It takes you an hour to get from there to there. And notice that that's three bus routes to make a trip that stays on the same street. I don't really understand why I need to go to South McGregor in order to make it over there. What do we do under the reimagined system? We do the logical thing. The number 7 bus just keeps going. It crosses Main Street. It keeps going the third ward. It hits TSU, it hits U of H, and ends at Eastwood Transit Center, or it connects to a bunch of other bus routes. What does this do? It makes crosstown trips a lot easier. And I think that's a very big deal for communities like the third ward. There's an awful lot of jobs out on the west side. And this makes those jobs accessible to people who live over here and are dependent on transit. And on the flip side, if you're in Gulfton, this is educational opportunity. This means you can get to U of H and get your college degree. If you look at the outer ends of the system, you see very similar kinds of improvements. This is the Northwest Corridor. Notice how all these bus routes just kind of fizzle out in the middle of nowhere? I want to get from here to here. What does that involve? I mean, you can see sort of the lack of connectivity here. Here's a reimagined system. We're pulling everything up into West Little York Park and Ride up there and making those connections at the outer end. Notice how everything is crossing, everything is meeting, and the Park and Ride connection's a really nice thing too. This now means a bus from up here to Memorial City. I bet there will be people who will do that, who will park there in order to get to Memorial City. I mean, it's not in an HOV lane, but it does mean you don't have to worry about the traffic, and you can sit there and get some work done or get some reading done. So, in terms of frequent access, I mentioned this already, we're trying to get people where they want to go. We are doubling the number of people within half a mile of the frequent network and increasing the number of jobs within half a mile of the frequent network by 55%. This is about opportunity. This is about jobs. This is about education. This is about people having affordable places to live where they can get somewhere on transit. And let's talk about weekend service. Current Saturday, current Sunday, reimagined weekend service. What we are saying is every bus route will run the same on Sunday as it does at midday on a Monday. Not a single bus route goes away on the weekend, and all of the frequent routes are frequent. So what does that mean for our riders? Currently on a weekday, 49% of our current riders are getting on the bus at a location with frequent service, 25% on a weekend. This takes that up to 3/4 of our current riders are currently boarding at the stop that has frequent service. Right now, 5% of our riders are boarding at stops that have no service on Sunday. And look at what that does. And notice even the 30-minute, the number of people who get 30-minute service on the weekends has dramatically expanded, and even on the weekdays expanded. On top of that, huge positive impacts for current riders. 93% of riders will find a bus at the exact same bus stop they get on at today. And out of the remaining 7%, 6.5% are within quarter mile of a new bus stop. The remainder, nearly all of them, are less than half a mile. For example, not within this quarter figure, the Alabama bus goes away under this. Alabama is within walking distance of Richmond and Westheimer for its entire length. But some of that is just barely over a quarter mile. So that's where you're seeing some of those numbers. And notice, like I said, 99,000 more current boardings on all these services. Let's talk about speed, because travel time does really matter. So the team looked at this network, looked at 30 different spots across this network, and ran a matrix of what are those travel times. That's a lot of work. And so the question is, what did that do to travel times? These are those 30 centers, and as you look through them, this is the average improvement in travel time for trips from each of those centers to the other 29 locations. Notice north side of FM-1960, 30 minutes average travel time improvement. As you go through this, look at all of those numbers. If you look at all of our trips, of those pairs, 28% of them get 20 minutes or more faster, 58% get 10 minutes or more faster. This will get people where they're going a lot more quickly. So how does that happen? Part of that is simply frequency, especially on connections. If you have to wait less for the bus, your trip's definitely faster. But some other things we're doing. Taking fewer buses through downtown. Downtown is one of the slower places to operate a bus. It is not a very efficient transit center. So by not feeding all of these buses through downtown, we get a huge improvement. What else do we do? We get rid of some of these deviations. Apparently this one exists because at some point the street was closed for a utility repair and it never got routed back. There's a handful of people in this neighborhood who get on this bus, but for every person who gets on, there's, 20 people on the bus who are getting detoured out of their way. You look all over the system and you see these. You ever see a bus that says 50 Harrisburg via Detroit? That means this bus will make a beeline for Hobby Airport until it's about 2 miles away, and then it'll just get distracted and wander off to a neighborhood before heading back to Hobby again. We are doing a lot of these things where we're really slowing down trips with these kind of deviations. We're also moving connection locations so they actually make sense. If you live in the Heights and you want to go out to Memorial City, our current system says travel east into downtown and then travel back west to get to Memorial City. The new system says just catch the bus to the Northwest Transit Center and transfer there. That, in this trip, saves 39 minutes by putting that connection spot in the right place. And you see all over this system these amazing connection spots. This is Northwest Transit Center, and every bus route that goes into Northwest Transit Center, look how far flung that is. Look at how many places are connected. Eastwood Transit Center on the east side. So these connection points that really connect people where they want to go very effectively. And we're also looking at reliability. High-frequency routes are huge for reliability. You're making connection from one bus to another. I was on this exact bus on Lyons and going over to the Houston Food Bank. The Houston Food Bank is served by an hourly bus. Our bus got stuck behind train number one, and that puts us 5 minutes late, and I'm looking at my connection time, I'm gonna miss this. And then we just barely missed being stopped by train number two, two railroad crossings later. If we had been stopped by that, I would have missed my bus, I would have sat at the transit center for 50 minutes. I was going to a meeting, but if I've been going to work and that happens a couple times, I don't have a job anymore. If I am connecting to a frequent bus and it runs every 15 minutes, worst case is 15 minutes delay, no matter what happens on the trip over. That's a huge deal. But it's also a lot of details. 30% decrease in the number of times buses have to cross freight rail tracks. It's a huge benefit in terms of reliability, and fewer of the extremely long and unreliable. And then, if you look at this system, it's very easy to expand. You can extend the grid on the outside. You can dial up the frequency of routes. You can add in routes and gaps in the grid, and there's also a potential for real express service in here. For example, between downtown and Northwest Transit Center, we're showing two routes, both frequent, the local via Washington Avenue and the express via the freeway. That express route means significant travel time savings for people who are not going to a destination on Washington Avenue. But if you're going on Washington Avenue, you have the choice of the local. There's potential to put a lot more of those express routes in here. So as we get more funds, especially under the referendum, which moves funds from roads to buses, we'll be able to do things like that. So I've talked about the timeline, hoping to implement in 2015. Let me talk about some of the other things that are important to this. One is branding. This is what Portland does at a stop with frequent service. Notice the frequent service flag. Notice the bus route says frequent. Notice there's a map of what their frequent routes are. Unfortunately, they have budget cuts, so they're not all frequent anymore. But anyway, they do have a map of them. So even what you're seeing in this study is a start of that. I fully intend, and I think the team fully intends, that Metro will have this kind of map to help you navigate the system. Not just a regular bus map, but a series of maps that are really tailored to understand the system and find the service that serves you best. I also look at our bus stops. This is not a very useful bus stop.
No.
I used to ride the number 9 Gulfton. There's a stop on both sides of the street, and on one side of the street it says 9 Gulfton, on the other side of the street says 9 Gulfton. One of those goes downtown, one of those goes to Gulfton. How do you figure that out? We are going to have to redo every bus stop sign in town, so we might as well make them more useful. So does it look something like this? This is just, like I said, one board member out of 9. I'm just throwing an idea out there. But wouldn't it be nice if that told you where that bus is going and that it's westbound, and maybe even give you the name of the stop? If you're giving somebody directions, that might make things a lot easier. There's a connection at the stop to another route, so why don't we note that on the sign and tell you where to catch that bus?
That'd be awesome.
This is not, as capital projects go, this is not a particularly big capital project, but I think it could do a lot of good for our riders. And Metro for ages has had the policy that we have a corporate identity and everything needs to look the same. I don't really feel a park and ride bus and a frequent local bus and an infrequent local bus are the same thing. And Metro, why shouldn't we start to designate this? Why don't we say that all of our frequent buses will be served by buses that actually say right on the side, this is frequent service? Really make people aware of what's up. So there's all sorts of potentials there. This here is an amazing document. The first blog post I ever wrote on intermodality, long before I was a board member, was about how our park and ride network really needs a map that's more like a rail map and less like a bus map. Park and ride riders don't care how many curves there are in the freeway between the park and ride lot and their final destination. They care about connectivity. This, from the consulting team, is the first official map of the park and ride network that actually treats it that way. And really, I think maps like this can change how people think of the system. But there's other pieces to this, because fundamentally, transit riders aren't riding from stop to stop. They're riding from destination to destination. This is a really nice bus stop. It's got a nice shelter, it's got a bench, it's got a concrete pad. Is this a really nice place to get on the bus? And look at that poor pedestrian right there. San Antonio, we're making fun of another city here, but you can find plenty of places in Houston like that. So here's one of those places. This is, when I worked for Matrix Structural Engineers, we officed in Greenway Plaza, and I took the number 9 bus to get there. So what did I do every morning? Rode the bus, got out here. I am now on the wrong side of the street, and there are 5 lanes of speeding, high-speed traffic between me and the other side of the street. So me and the kids that were going to the junior high school would just look for a gap in traffic and make a dash for it. There is no crosswalk there. There is no light there. It's not safe, frankly. Then we get to here. We've got a street, that's good, it leaves where I'm trying to go, but it has no sidewalk. So I'm walking in the street to here, across to here, into the building. Now, the junior high school students who are trying to get here, they have it a little worse. They go to here, there's another street here, they don't connect, so they climb through a gap in the hedge and walk past the loading dock of the Home Depot, and that will get them to their school. So the kind of pedestrian pedestrian infrastructure we have really matters. This is a sidewalk that's going to get fixed, but there you see a really nice, wonderful light rail line, and you see the basic infrastructure we have for connecting to it. And this is not something Metro can solve by itself. This is something where we need the city, we need the county, we need developers, we need everyone helping to really get people to those transit stops. And luckily, I am seeing that happening now. Here you see a project to actually rebuild sidewalks leading to light rail stations on the north side. This is not a Metro project. And what's wonderful about it is notice you rebuilt the sidewalk and not the street. I think that's notable that we as a region are starting to get this right. Now here's another problem, and I'm going to pick on HCC for a little bit. This is HCC's West Loop campus. It is on a freeway frontage road. A frontage road is one way. Bus service by its nature is two way. So what happens when a major institution that's a major destination is on the frontage road? If I'm riding the bus this way, it's great. Bus stop, walk to the front door, I'm in good shape. If I'm riding the other way, I can't get off here since there's no way to cross the freeway. So that's the path in the other direction. If we have a destination like this, there's nothing we can do to get good bus service here because the street network literally will not allow it. And even if you look at the reimagined map, it's full of these kind of things. This is a loop we're doing to serve an HCC campus that is very inconveniently located. This is a narrow ditch street that really, by any standard, shouldn't have bus service on it, but it was the only way to figure out how to get in here. Now, I pick on HCC because I actually see HCC increasingly doing this right. This is a really good place to put a college campus. Put it next to a transit center and it's really easy to get there. But I'm still seeing a lot of health clinics, I'm still seeing a lot of things being put in places where they're incredibly difficult to serve with transit. So as a region, we need to do a lot better. And I would say, for all the planners sitting here, this is something that planners can play a huge role in. You know, anybody involved in a college expansion project, talk about how are we getting transit riders to these new educational buildings that we're building. So that is the plan. We are holding public meetings across the region. You'll see the schedule on the Metro website. We are also going out to wherever we are asked. We've spoken to a bunch of neighborhood groups. So if you have a group you want us to speak to, let us know and we will get out there and we will spread the message. And we've even been meeting our riders at transit centers, really trying everything we can to get as much good input as we can. Our website is incredibly detailed with this information and it also gives you a chance to provide feedback. We really want your comments on this plan. And for right now, I really welcome your questions on this plan.
What about the airports?
Airports? Okay. I love really like the number one question I always get asked. I will start with the bad news. Airports are lousy for transit riders. The best airport transit connection you will find in the United States, I would argue, is Washington, D.C. at National Airport. It's a great rail system. The stop is right at the terminal. The airport has a single terminal, and the traffic is horrific. So that will get you into downtown D.C. wonderfully. About 15% of the people flying into the airport use that connection. That's the high end. And the reason for that is twofold. First of all, there's a lot of business travelers on expense accounts for whom money is no object. They don't care if they're paying 70 bucks for a cab because their company's going to pay for it anyway. And secondly, you add on top of that leisure travelers with a little too much luggage and a couple of screaming kids. They probably don't want to get on the bus either. It's hard enough to get to Disney World with your kids in your car. So transit ridership at airports is not good. We tried an express service to Intercontinental. I'm guessing like two people on it. Bus. That makes no sense. I want to put that bus somewhere where it's full. However, this plan actually has improvements. You'll notice Hobby Airport gets frequent service 7 days a week that connects to the light rail line on the east end, as well as frequent service out of Fan and South. So if you're getting to Hobby, you will have frequent service all week, connects to two different rail lines with good connection, a bunch of our job centers. And the bus that comes to the east end also goes to Eastwood Transit Center. So I could do one connection on frequent service from right here to Hobby Airport. For Intercontinental, I'm actually one of the few people who ride the airport bus to Intercontinental. I will take the 102. It takes an hour from downtown. The And the reason for that is sort of slithers through the back roads of Greens Point for a while. That bus gets about 15 minutes faster under this plan because that local segment gets picked up by another bus. So there is not a focus on connecting to the airport since the ridership isn't there, but we're actually improving connections to both airports.
What about connections to our little bitty Amtrak station?
There's a frequent bus going by it, so you know, there's 6 trains a week, so yes, you can get to Dunlin Metro.
How significant are the number changes going to be on the buses? Because I think I saw one that was like the 20, or one was like the 45 initially, and it changed to a different number?
We are changing every bus number.
And so how long do you think, well, how difficult do you think that'll be for the average rider to then try to figure out, because I imagine that would take some time and may cause a little bit more concern with the project?
This is going to be a really interesting moment. We're planning to change every bus route in Houston over a weekend. And yes, that is a huge deal. That is all of those current riders, you know, 200,000 people suddenly doing something different. And you can believe me, we are going to have the most intensive effort you have ever seen to get that information out there. It's signs at bus stop, it's signs on the buses, it's education of all the bus riders. Every Metro employee we can spare standing at a bus stop or a transit center that Monday morning, I'll probably be out there helping, you know, I'll take some vacation time for work and help people navigate the system. I actually think the route numbering changes help, because I think it would actually be a lot worse. I mean, these routes are changing fundamentally. There, I mean, some looks, the Westheimer bus looks pretty similar, but there's really fundamental changes. And if we tried to keep the same numbers, I think that'd actually be a lot more confusing. If I got on a bus at the same stop I always got on, with the same number I always got on, and it took me to a different place. So I think the numbering changes are actually useful, and the numbering changes are intended to bring some logic to the system.
I want to say thanks for a very lucid presentation. I'm very excited. I'm going to my community meeting tomorrow.
Excellent.
I wonder, who feels like they're losing in this? How are the community meetings going? Are there people who feel like they're losing?
Well, actually, Jeff, you could speak to the meetings much better than I can.
So I think we've had a lot of feedback. We've got a whole lot of very positive feedback that says, you know, sort of this finally, you know, we've been asking for this for a long time. And then we've had sort of a balance of, and then some people say, this is great, but X, you know, and it comes in two directions. One is, don't put the bus anywhere near me, and some is, you know, we need more service where we are. And usually what's happened is we try to talk to people about how decisions are made and explain to them that decisions are trying to be made in a much more consistent basis across the region based on where people live, where people ride the bus, where people work. There are some folks that have presented some really valuable feedback on how we could make it better if you could just make this one connection. And understanding we're trying to do this all within the same budget, so where we can do that and where this feedback provides those kind of opportunities, we're going to take that into account. We haven't gotten a whole lot of, you know, this is, we're losing kind of feedback so far, but that it may come, and that's why we're having such an extensive outreach process.
Just to give an idea of the fairness of this, one of the bus routes I ride most frequently actually the 53, which I took here today, and that's actually a connection which gets eliminated under this plan. Now, personally, I just love the idea of riding the rail line and picking up a frequent Richmond bus, because it means, you know, the 53 is every 20 minutes, every half hour, depending. I've really got to plan my life around it, so I actually like this better. But yes, they are picking on the routes I ride too, so.
Are there future transit centers, and where would they be located?
I think, Jeff, you can probably speak to this a little bit. We are going to look at what capital projects are suggested by this plan. This isn't dependent on any new capital project.
What was the question?
Are there future transit centers, and where would they be?
So I think one of the things, there's two types of capital projects impacting transit centers. One is existing transit centers. Christoph showed some maps about how a lot of them, some of them have a lot more service coming into them at once, which allows you to make connections to many more places. So there will be a need to think through both short-term and long-term capacity and operations at transit centers. A place like Northwest Transit Center, which is really the center it's sort of the center of Houston at this point in terms of density of jobs and of the bus network. A lot of stuff is coming in there that allows you to get to many other places. There's going to need to be some real thought about how that evolves over time, and with the advent of 290 and I-10 and HOV lane, there's some real thinking that needs to happen. The uptown dedicated bus lane project, all that needs to work together. But that's a little bit of a longer term process. There are some other places in the system where a lot more connectivity is happening. Right now, some of that can happen. You know, there are some systems that really don't use the transit center concept. You just make a transfer on street. And so there are short-term and then long-term opportunities where that could happen. A place like Memorial City, there's a lot more connectivity that will be available there. And so that's one of the discussions that will have to happen. But that's not just a metro discussion. It's going to require working with local property owners, with local, you know, and making sure that it works for everybody as well as possible. And there are a few, and there are some that actually have less service and may need to be rethought about how they're being used as well.
Yeah, I think in earlier metro planning sometimes overdid the transit center thing, that a lot of times that connection and intersection is actually a better way to connect, because the bus doesn't have to loop out of its way to do that. So I think a lot of what I want to see here is a real focus on some of these key intersections. You know, just make sure that intersection has good crosswalks, sidewalks, good bus stops in every quadrant. But Jeff brings up Memorial City. I mean, in the future, this may lead to bigger projects. Like, one of the things that really intrigues me looking at Memorial City is there's a bunch of jobs there, now a frequent Gesture bus going down to West Chase Memorial City. I wish there was a way for the buses that were in the managed lanes in the middle of I-10 to stop there and set up a connection to that, so you could get on a park and ride out near Katy and actually go to West Chase by transferring at that location. That's not an easy project, and it's not a cheap project, but you could see how a plan like this would start to suggest those kinds of things.
Why the focus on Sunday ridership? What evidence do you have that that's what drivers want?
What was?
Why the focus on Sunday frequent bus service?
Well, we've heard from a lot of people that that's really something that they want. Mm-hmm. And like I said, if you just look at when jobs are, there is significant demand there. You're actually seeing, I just recently saw a magazine article about how more and more systems are looking at the weekend service. The other great thing about weekend service is it's relatively cheaper to add. It doesn't add buses to it. Our bus fleet is sized for peak hours, so you don't need any more buses to handle that service. So we can relatively, compared to adding peak service, adding off-peak service is actually less expensive. Weekends are one of those problems and one of those things where you have to think about how you analyze ridership. The problem that transit agencies have is they often get themselves in this defeating spiral. You know, a bus runs every 45 minutes and nobody's riding it, so let's run it every hour. You know, that you provide lousy service and nobody rides it, and you use the lack of ridership as a justification for making the service even lousier. So the judgment of our consultants, and I agree with them, is if we provide much better service on Sunday, it will significantly grow the ridership on Sunday. But I can't point to that ridership today because, frankly, people are not riding because the service is so bad.
I would just add, I think it increases ridership on Sunday, but it also increases ridership on Tuesday. Because if you need a car for your Sunday trip, you're more likely to use it for your Tuesday trip. And so by being there when people need it all the time, you know, a road doesn't go away on Sunday. It's still there when you need it. You need sort of that, if you're going to make transit one of your primary mobility choices, it needs to be there, you know, as much of the time as you need it as possible.
Another thing Jared Walker said that I thought was a really smart point in that direction is never cancel the last bus of the day, even if it has low ridership, because the last bus is the safety net for the second to last bus. The reason why people are riding the second to last bus is because the last bus exists and they know they won't be stranded. And it's very much the same thing for evening service and weekend service. It's making people feel comfortable with relying on them. Okay?
Considering the room we're in, I'm thinking about, you know, really what you're doing here is redesigning the system to be human-centric and being agnostic of old alliances and bureaucracies, and you're saying, let's rethink how the most humans can benefit from this. How might you apply that to the 2040 regional transportation plan?
I'll make a general comment rather than a been revolutionized over the last two decades, especially by computer technology. These vast databases of information we have and these GIS tools that can process all of that. The majority of transportation planning uses GIS to draw a map of a decision that was made without the benefit of any of that data. We are using GIS merely to justify decisions that were made by a hunch. What this plan is doing is it's starting with the data and actually making those decisions based on data. And that really changes your way of thinking. I mean, I remember once long ago, I was in a university line meeting, I was talking to a metro planner, and was asking why there were more stations in Gulfton. And they said, well, we think that there's two kinds of service. There's urban service where you provide more stations and suburban service where you try to go as fast as possible. And we think of outside of 610 as suburban and inside 610 as urban. So this planner had a model in their head of what the region looked like that was completely wrong. And that's the problem with not using the data, is you start to work off of assumptions which may or may not be right. So I wish the people who sit at this table at the TPC were making decisions based on this wealth of data that we have about what our region is actually like, not what we think it's like.
So what is your data telling you about the impact of this 4599 thing, new campus they're building out there, the Exxon?
We're going to lose transit ridership over it, no doubt about it. Because right now, Exxon's downtown in the midst of a great transit network. They've got a bunch of their people using park and ride. We can't provide that level of service out there. It's simply impossible. And so I think it's dumb to move that many employees out there. And I think they'll probably have people employed over it. But you know, obviously, Exxon can make whatever decision they want. What I will say is there is an underutilized resource in the park and rides. We run empty buses, reverse direction, morning and afternoon. Some of those are scheduled. A lot of those are not. They're deadheading. And so there's a chance. Exxon has employees who live in places like the Heights or Midtown. And could we get those people on the park and rides going the reverse direction? Could they catch the Westheimer bus and then transfer to a park and ride downtown and head out there? And the answer is no, because we can't run a bus into the Exxon campus. There's a security gate, and we can't run our bus inside that gate. And frankly, those buildings are not within walking distance of the security gate.
Yeah.
However, Exxon can. If we make a bus bay available to them at our park and ride for Exxon to have an employee shuttle that connects right there, that could absolutely happen. And so I really would like for partnerships between Metro and employers to do things like that. You go to San Francisco, one of the most amazing transit stories in the United States is Caltrain, which was a commuter service from bedroom communities on the peninsula up to San Francisco. All the ridership was one way in the morning, all the ridership was the other way. That's now a two-way service because you have Silicon Valley at the other end, and you have a bunch of people who work for Silicon Valley companies in really drab office parks want to live in cool neighborhoods like the Mission, and they're riding the train southbound in the morning, covered commute. And what those companies are doing is they're sending shuttles to those stations. And so you get off the train, and there's an Adobe shuttle sitting there waiting to get those employees to their work. I think we could do more of that.
I'm really excited about the additional service on the weekends. But what about late night service for people who work overnight in the hospitality industry and things like that?
I think I'm going to point to Jeff.
So one of the things that we recognize is that Houston is moving towards sort of a 24/7 city. One of the things, as much as possible, particularly on those frequent routes, those spans of service are 18 to up to 21 hours a day. So it leaves a relatively small window, kind of, you know, 1 to 4 a.m. But over time, that's one of the things that we recommend that Metro continue to look at with incremental funding, is really trying to enhance spans as much as possible for entertainment. You know, like you had weekend service, now people want to get to the ballpark, they want to get to dining, up to the bar, and all that kind of, you know, trying to make sure that you're there when people want to use the service. With the current service, as much as possible, that's been done, but it isn't always possible with the level of resources, but I think that there's definitely places where that kind of focus really needs to happen. You're seeing a lot of cities moving, like, you know, a 24-hour rail service, and that's something that a lot of people are moving to, and we think over time that's something Metro needs.
balance between rider-based thinking and bus-based thinking. Like I was talking to, this wasn't Houston, I was talking to a transit agency guy once about why don't the buses run later on the weekends? And he said, we never want to run a bus after closing time at the bar, since those guys will just get on the bus and throw up on the bus line, which is logical until I think a little further and say, I'd rather have that guy throwing up on the bus than driving home. And so it starts to be about what are your priorities and what you're trying to do here. And what we're trying to do is a system that's really based on people's needs, not based on what's easy to operate.
Is there being any consideration of how to prioritize bus movement over single occupancy car movement within the city or other than the HOV lanes?
Well, I mean, the Uptown project, obviously, is an example of that, doing a dedicated bus lane. And we're doing the opposite of what most cities are doing with dedicated bus lanes. You look at most BRT projects, and they have dedicated lanes where it's easy to provide them. So what you will find is they have dedicated lanes on the uncongested portions of the route. And as soon as they get into a congested area, they mix in with traffic. We're actually doing the opposite in Uptown, is we're putting a dedicated lane in the most congested part of the region. And if you look at the regional benefits of that project, the TxDOT modeler guys have looked at that and said, this is one of the best projects we've ever seen in terms of congestion benefit. We just need to make sure we get all our pieces together and actually build that project. I mean, there's some fairly narrow-minded opposition to that, and it's an amazing project in terms of getting access. I would love to see a lot more of that, and one of the really neat pieces of this is we got the stakeholders in the room from the beginning. So we have public works people, we have planning people, and we're getting that question from City of Houston Public Works now. They're asking us, what can we do to make your buses more reliable? And I think that's amazing. So I think there's a lot of potential to do a lot.
I have a comment and a question. One thing, I really like the lady's question over there regarding weekend service. If you want to attach a face to a problem, I live out in the La Porte area. There is absolutely no way to get into town on weekends. I'm here at this meeting because it's during the week. So, you know, there are riders if you need inputs. Your poster child. Anyway, but I noticed on the comparison that you did to other metropolitan areas, comparing Houston to them, I noticed that, you probably looked at this, the comparison wasn't made to cities that are larger than us in the U.S., namely L.A., Chicago, New York City. Two of those cities I think of perhaps as being more developed than our mass transit system, and one probably worse than our.
But no,
what,
I will
what
actually.
Do you think? Can you comment to that?
I will actually say I think all three of those actually have very good frequent networks.
Yeah.
New York's a little bit of an unfair comparison. They are a much larger metropolitan area than we are. I'll do this. I know, actually know the San Francisco area pretty well. I think if you were to do this, part of the problem with the San Francisco area is it has too many bus agencies and not one good source for information. So it would have taken me forever to figure out what all the frequent routes were, which is why I didn't map it. But I will tell you, I suspect that if you map San Francisco, you'll see a bright white spot covering the 49 square miles of San Francisco, and you will see that once you get out of there, there's none. I actually wouldn't be surprised. This is a larger frequent service net footprint than the San Francisco Bay Area. Los Angeles, I don't know what their weekend service is like. Their weekday footprint is quite good. They actually have a very good grid-based system. I'd say they have one of the best bus systems in the country. So there is real variety there. I thought that was a fair comparison in terms of metro areas that are closer to our size. LA, New York. I mean, people make the city size comparison in terms of the population within city limits. But if you look at metro area, remember, we're down there around number 10. And so I think in terms of age of cities and size of cities, that's a pretty decent comparison. Yes, New York definitely looks better. Maps, as it's actually the first time I've seen the map, low income population density. Not what percentage of a census tract is low income, but how many low income residents there are per square mile. And this plan serves that a lot better than the current system does. This is one of those things where in people's minds,
a lot of people think the east side of town is low income and the west side of town is rich, basically. Not true. You look at Gulfton, you look at Spring Branch, and you will see significant low-income populations in areas that are traditionally very badly served by our system. So in terms of low-income access, you want to look at minorities, very similar thing, you want to look at seniors, this is actually a huge improvement. The other thing I will say that's one of the sort of really important things is I hate it when people divide the world into transit-dependent and non-transit-dependent people, because that is really a spectrum. There are people who are right on that line where they have to have a car to get to their job, but they're scrimping on their groceries to be able to afford that car. There are people who may take a lower paying job within walking or biking distance because they can't get to that better paying job on the other side of town. So there are people who are not riding the bus today who desperately need that service. And I think a lot of them will see a real improvement.
No, I just would emphasize that a lot of work was spent trying to make sure that people maintain access to the system, and that we're trying to provide different tools like the flexible service in areas that tend to have older, sort of aging populations where people don't make as many work-based trips, but need to go to the grocery store, need to go to a clinic, they need to see their friends in their neighborhood. That really provides them a much better service for those types of trips, and so it opens up the toolbox that Metro has available to meet the needs of different neighborhoods specifically.
Let's imagine for a moment that, say, in a couple years, we weren't spending a quarter of our transit taxes on slush funds and roads. How would you expand this project with substantial more funding, and would it mean another huge bump in ridership gains?
First of all, the good news is we won't be spending a quarter. That quarter is now scaling down for the first time in the history of Houston Transit. And those additional funds we get to the referendum, which are earmarked for bus projects, that lets us do a lot of what we talked about. And I think, Jeff, you can talk through what kind of service we might be able to add here.
We looked at a lot of different things. I mean, clearly, we don't have as much resource. We'd love to run frequent service. You know, there's a lot of trade-offs that have to be made in this plan that, you know, if you just had a few more percentage points of funding that you could operate things. We've got a lot of requests of why am I on a semi-frequent route and not a frequent route all the time. And it's a hard thing to say, you know, we don't have the resources and trade-offs that always have to be made in a resource-constrained plan. I mean, I think I would compliment the board for saying this is not a wish list. This is really trying to do with what we can. But I think there's lots of projects like the dedicated bus lane in uptown. Part of the reason that some of the frequent service is available to expand is the investment that's been made in rail that allows you to have that kind of capacity, that kind of reliability and speed that you can tie into. So as you add more of those types of projects, it only has sort of a compounding effect on how the bus network can improve.
So. No, and I think that, like, for example, one email I got the other day, somebody saying, why isn't the curvy bus frequent? And the simple answer to that is because we don't have more money. You know, that's one of those routes you could look at and say, I can make a justification for frequent service. But Shepherd has frequent, the cross streets have frequent. You work through your list of priorities, that doesn't make the top of that list of priorities. But as the area continues to grow and we get more revenue, it may well make the list of priorities.
When and where might there be the next rail line?
Well, we are opening two new rail lines probably in December for Southeast and East. And I think beyond that, you look at the referendum and what the voters voted for was an east-west line that goes through Greenway Plaza that connects the West Side job centers to the Main Street line. And it seems fairly obvious to me that ought to be the next one. I will also say that I think those kind of decisions ought to be made here instead of Washington.
In designing the new network, have you come across areas that would make a lot of sense to integrate, but they're outside the service area, therefore they can't be touched?
Oh, I mean, we mentioned it earlier. Well, the port's not in the service area. We can't improve service there. I mean, one of the biggest holes in the region is Pasadena. You look at the density, you look at the street grid, you look at the relationship to the rest of the network, and if you just looked at the population data and you looked at this map, you would ask yourself, why aren't those routes on the east side continuing going to Pasadena? It's because they are not in Metro. That's not Metro's decision. That's Pasadena's decision. And so far, they haven't come to us and said we'd like to join. So what we're focused on is serving our service area. But I will say that across the region, one of our biggest transportation problems is that once you leave the Metro service area, there are no dedicated transit funding sources. Everywhere else, transit is either trying to compete for a limited pot of federal funds that Congress could take away at any moment, or it's competing in the general fund against all the other needs that, cities and counties have. And that's a big disadvantage for those areas outside the service area. And that's not a problem Metro can solve, but I think as a region, it's a huge problem.
Could Pasadena join next year if they, wanted?
I think it may take...
I can comment to that. Pasadena has basically been an impediment to the entire Bay Area connecting into a Metro system. We do have a system in LaPorte and Baytown called Harris County Transit, and maybe perhaps you've already communicated with them.
They were on the stakeholder group.
Oh, good. But yeah, we don't have a, forward-thinking mayor and city council in Pasadena. That's what's blocked us.
I think it would take an act of the legislature, but that's if they wanted to, the legislature would pass that.
So thank you all very much for coming on. A couple of quick notes. I want to thank the American Planning Association for co-sponsoring this, you guys, and you know, they're the ones who do the planning, and hopefully, although it's amazing how many engineers are doing planning these days instead of planners, but there you go. I wanted to thank Jeff Table and the Community and Environmental Department for letting us be in this building for so many years, and it cost them something to do that, so thank you very much. Now, we are going to have the second annual Catalyst Awards on October 1st, and we will award people who are game changers and who are catalysts and change our quality of life. And so put that on your calendar for October 1st, 6:30 to 9. And also you can find us, of course, at HoustonTomorrow.org, and I assume a lot of you already are getting our newsletter. But finally, I want to thank Christoph, and not just for coming here to do this, but for this incredible work that he's done since he's been here.
We also need to really recognize Metro staff, and I would say especially Kurt Larson, who's a senior vice president for planning, who is amazing and who has a trait that is unlike most transit planning people I know. He rides the bus. So he knows the system as well as anyone, and his leadership has been a huge part of making this project possible.
And thanks to all of you for all you do to make Houston a better place to live.